Family lair, and further to your left, the entrance to what I believe and understand to be the monks' dormitory living area, lay brothers. But of course, the bit that's missing, the bit that I'm standing on, is the connection between the abbey and the abbot's house. And of course, this boundary wall we have to be in the graveyard would have not been there. So that's just to orientate us. We left each other talking about the Nardier in Notts Abbey, 1492, the murder by William Butler, and then the resurgence of some sort of order by two particularly abbots. In 1528, we have this nomination of this abbot of Kinloss. Robert Reed was probably born around 1490, born, I think, in Fife, the son of a nobleman, well educated, went to St Andrews University, and the first time that he formally appears on the Murray chart is in 1524 as Four years later, he's elected as abbot of Kinloss, an extraordinary fast promotion. 3 years after that, he's the commendator of Beaulieu Priory, and he has his own ferry to take him between Fintorn and Beaulieu. And 10 years after that, his career as a cleric, as a churchman, includes then the bishopric of Orkney, and he sets about the most massive refurbishment of the bishop's palace in Kirkwall. A staggering career for a churchman alone. But he does so much more. He makes Kinloss Abbey the centre of academic excellence. He recruits, as he becomes abbot, Giovanni Ferrerio, a well-known European scholar from Piedmont. And he tasks Giovanni to set up a centre of excellence and a library and Kinloss. He's here for 5 years. Giovanni and Robert Reed write a continuation of the history of Scotland. Gothic style that I spoke of before, and at certain stages, or they're pure forms of asceticism, adornments, decoration were scorned, but clearly not now, and Andrew Blairham, a prominent local artist, was commissioned to undertake this work. So he builds a formal library. And this centre of academic excellence sees its dividend in Robert Reed's death in 1558, when he bequeaths as a legacy the enormous sum of 6,000 marks to establish a centre of learning in Edinburgh. This becomes the endowment of Edinburgh University, and in 1582, a royal charter establishes Edinburgh as the sixth university in Britain and the fourth university in Scotland. But I want to add to this and talk to you about Robert Reed as a wealthy diplomat and statesman. He was a king's official. In 1537, he's used by King James V to advise and negotiate the terms of the marriage between James V and Princess Madeleine, the daughter of the King of France. Madeleine marries James V, returns to Scotland, and dies almost immediately. But history doesn't relate whether it's the weather or the fellow Scots that brought about this down. But a year later, it requires Robert Reed, again as King's Commissioner, to return to France to negotiate the marriage of James V with Mary of Guise. Years after that, we see Robert Reed going back to Paris, to Notre Dame, to attend the wedding of Mary Queen of Scots. And interestingly, Elgin Borough donates £29 to help defray the travel costs of Robert Reed to and fro Paris. But I said wealth. And we are talking about wealth. In 1561, that's just after Robert Reed died, we have the situation whereby the annual income of Kinloss Abbey, I told you earlier that it was a third of what Melrose had as earnings, was £3,480. And Kinloss is the third most wealthy establishment after Melrose and the abbey at Cooper Angus. But it wasn't all income, there were some outgoings. And annually, Robert Reed had to pay 800 marks to Lord John Stuart, one of James V's illegitimate sons, as an annual fee for the privileges and the positions that he held. Slab stones to limit the growth of the taproot, and apparently, although there don't seem to be many people nowadays that agree with him, they increase the fruit on all the fruit trees. I think the end result of this is, of course, that this is pivotal in increasing the productivity, agricultural productivity, the fruit growing productivity of the Lake of Murray. The Lake of Murray, which then undoubtedly spread from Landride in the east to Rowley in the west. I've touched on water management of the Cistercians, and it's difficult to see now, but the Kinloss Burn runs some 100 metres behind one. But during the time of Robert Reed, the water flow was diverted and ran through, and we will see some of the, what some people call a drain, but I prefer to call an aqueduct, running through a sort of tar, water, and sustenance. I also want to that I would raise is that most monasteries had a herb garden, because herbs then had very important roles in both medicine and as preservatives. So we come to the Reformation then, the primary passing of Robert III giving up the abbacy in 1553. But again, we touch upon the passing of John to Walter III, his nephew. This is where patronage is beginning to get away in the way of talent. And Walter Reed unfortunately coincides with the Reformation. Robert Reed was always of the view that there was some way that Catholicism and Protestantism could be united and a way forward found. But that wasn't the key. So Walter takes advantage of the Reformation. He marries and quickly raises a family. He sells considerable abbey lands before his death, and the temporal lordship of Kinloss passes to an Edinburgh lawyer and judge, Edward Bruce, who then calls himself the first Earl of Kinloss. In 1643, the lands here were sold to Alexander Brodie of Lethem, a family that still exists at Lethem, and though stonework that was part of this huge edifice of a transept, a nave, the abbot's house, is sold on the stone to build the house. And there's a brave local by the name of Ryan, a name that is well known to us around here, who went in 1650, the then proprietor, the Laird of Lethem, dominated the abbot's house, was allowed to collapse. And so today we have a historic and parish graveyard. The Commonwealth War broke in 1711. 73 graves, great majority from the time of the Second World War. One grave from the First World War, 1814. To break up aircraft at the end of the war when aircraft was surplus, and then it's transferred to Coastal Command, and then I suppose the saddest day of all, the crash of Afghanistan in 2006 on X-ray Victor 230, and now the translation of RAF Kinloss into Kinloss Barracks, but a continuation of a Commonwealth War Graves presence here and the ubiquitous cross of sacrifice. So we're now in a Moray Council graveyard with all the pressures that our council faces, and they must be complimented on some marvellous repairs, which we'll see in a moment, to the tower of the abbot's house, which undoubtedly saved it from collapse in the same way that the gable had collapsed. Again, the better known, better understood, and better funded, so that we have better links with the community here in Mykonos, so that we have better links with the community in Murray. And so I must really leave this part here and repeat to you my belief that Mykonos Abbey really is a unknown jewel in the Murray historical crown, and that Robert Reed is undoubtedly, in my mind, the most remarkable churchman, statesman, lawyer,